The two men walked side by side down the road. Brothers. His brother had always been the favorite. His brother was always the one that mom and dad were so proud of. His brother was the one that always seemed to get everything he wanted because he was the goody two shoes. His brother was the one that got all the benefits because everybody liked him. He was always the first one picked. He was always athletic. He had the personality and the charisma. All the ladies came around like, oh, he's a... And he was pretty sick of it. He was tired of his brother getting everything, which meant there was never anything left over for him. He was tired of his brother getting all the attention, and nobody even noticed how hard he worked. Nobody thanked him for the way that he contributed to the family. Nobody thanked him for the way that he contributed to the community. It was always about his brother. It even seemed like God liked him more. And now it had gone too far. So he and his brother walked out into their farmland. And as they walked, his anger and his bitterness and his jealousy turned to rage. His brother didn't really notice because he was walking along. I mean, life is good. Everything's fine. Of course it was fine. He's perfect. But as they walked, his brother just slightly ahead, he just began to rage. His heart pumping so hard and so fast, his blood pressure so high, you could see that vein in his forehead. And finally, they got out to where the tall crops were. He realized that nobody'd be able to see him out here. And as his brother walked just ahead, he bent down and he picked up a rock the size of a grapefruit. He'd worked with animals his whole life, and so, I mean, he was a big guy. It looked more like a softball in his hand. And because of working with animals, he was strong, and so the weight wasn't any problem. And over in his mind, he just kept replaying all the things that his brother had, all the things that his brother got to do, all the privileges that his brother experienced that he didn't have. And in a flash, he lunges toward his brother with that rock and hits him right in the back of his skull. It only took one shot. Abel's body dropped to the ground like a rag doll. Cain, standing there over a lifeless corpse with that big rock in his hand, all the things that had been pent up inside, suddenly he realized didn't die with his brother. Y'all are at tables this morning because I don't want to just stand up here and talk at you. I don't want to just tell you what you should think. I want you guys to do some thinking. I want you to consider some things for yourself. I'm going to ask you to collaborate on some things. And so if you didn't know the people at your table before, well, you will by the end of the morning because you guys are going to work together and I want you to come up with some ideas about some things and even be willing to share what you think. Now, you just heard a story that's found in the book of Genesis. And though I don't think any of you have played out that scenario to that extent, how many of you would go, Yeah, I may be. You don't even have to raise your hand, but yeah. I've had that kind of jealousy in my heart before. Maybe you have a sibling. Maybe you have a friend. That just seems to be the way their life goes, and you feel like you're missing out. And you've got these emotions in you that maybe you haven't considered or you don't know what to do with. And so we're going to talk about some of that today. And hopefully, think about this idea of jealousy in a new way. Think about it maybe in a way that you haven't before, some ways that we find in Scripture. Now, many times when we hear the word jealousy, we think of some of those feelings, right? But right now, around your tables, and Ben, you can go ahead and turn the lights back on. Right now, around your tables, I want you to discuss this. Clicker. Clicker. Discuss this. Okay, I got it. What does jealousy mean? Around your table, share with one another. I want to encourage you, if you're like a big talker, maybe let some other people get a word in edgewise, right? So right now, around your tables, talk about what does jealousy mean? What do you think about when you hear the word jealousy? What does that mean to you? Okay? Take a minute and talk about that.
Suffering, I do drink of its work. I do sing on it, my Savior, both bruised and crushed, showing that God is love and God is just.
So you guys can write down, if you want to, on that sheet of paper that's in front of you. That's there to kind of just help you gather your thoughts. Okay, 30 seconds. You call me out of death. You call me into life. I was under your wrath. Now through the cross, I'm reconciled. Okay. All right. So, what'd you come up with? All right. Who's got something when you hear the word jealousy, when you think about jealousy, what do you think? Peyton?
Greedy.
Okay.
Wanting what someone else has.
Wanting what someone else has. Good. What else? Yeah. Say it again.
Getting stressed over something that others have that you can't have.
Somebody who envies someone. We're going to talk about envy in a bit. That's a good word. Anger toward another person because of their success. Fear. All right. What else? So all these things that we think of are very common types of feelings. We've all felt these feelings. I remember when I think of jealousy,
One of the first pictures that comes to mind are high school boyfriends and girlfriends. Let me explain it to you this way. Okay, I remember people, Carter, will you come here and will you be my guinea pig since I'm not going to use anybody else in the room? All right, so this is my son. All right, now let's pretend Carter is my girlfriend. You're never going to live this down, I'm sorry. So I remember when I think about jealousy, here is the word picture that always comes to mind when it comes to high school boyfriends and girlfriends. You see these people, right? They walk around school and they've got their girl, right? Like this, and then, right? And they're hot, and everywhere they go. And then the girl says, I gotta go to the bathroom. And so she goes into the bathroom, and the guy stands there like he's in the Secret Service. He's looking around, and then at lunch, there's this, why did you look at that guy? Why did you look at it? What? It's because he has a truck, isn't it? It's because he had a, right? These insecure, and I remember how, you can sit down. Thank you. I remember how they're willing to give up physical comfort to be totally awkward and walk around like this. It's not comfortable. They're sitting in like an assembly or something, and the girl doesn't even get her own seat. She's got to share the seat with the guy because the guy's like, hurr. Right? And there's this jealousy, and it can go the other way too, where the girl goes, "Hey, why'd you look at her like that? Where, do you think I'm pretty? Do you like basically everything about me?" Right? And this idea of jealousy, of these insecurities and these things that we want that we can't have, or the fear, somebody said fear, that was a really good word, the fear that we're not going to measure up and that somebody else is going to be better. These are all the ways that we think about jealousy. And so therefore, based on that, we go, jealousy, you should never be jealous. Stop being jealous. It's a bad thing. It can only hurt you. And what I want to look at today, and what I hope that we'll see, is that is there the possibility for godly jealousy? Jealousy in a way that honors God and is healthy and is actually even necessary. So we're going to talk about this. And at your tables, there's a Bible, all right? There's a Bible at each table, and there are going to be some verses that you're going to look up, and they're there on your paper. And I want us to begin. What you're going to do is read it out loud for your table. So at a table with 8 people, I'm sure somebody is willing to read out loud. Or you can each read a verse, go around the table, everybody read a verse. But read, hold on. You're going to have plenty of time to talk. Read the verse, and then there are some questions underneath it. So, Exodus 34, 10 to 14. And then the questions underneath, what is God asking for? And then what does he mean when he says his name? So, look at those questions there that are grouped together. So, first, read Exodus 34, 10 to 14. Read it out loud so your table can hear it. Okay, before you begin discussion, I realize that with 8 tables and people reading, it can be kind of hard to hear. Let me read through this. So that way you can see and you can all hear. The Lord replied, listen. Now, this is to Moses. Up on Mount Sinai, he's getting the 10 commandments. Okay? God has just revealed himself. Remember, we talked about a couple weeks ago, God passed by him and told Moses, the Lord, the compassionate, gracious God, forgiving and loving kindness and all that, okay? The Lord replied, listen, I am making a covenant with you. That's a promise. With you in the presence of all your people. I will perform miracles that have never been performed anywhere in all the earth or in any nation. And all the people around you will see the power of the Lord, the awesome power I will display for you. But listen carefully to everything I command you today.
then I will go ahead of you and drive out the Amorites, the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Perizzites, the Hivites, and the Jebusites. Be very careful never to make a treaty with the people who live in the land where you are going. If you do, you will follow their evil ways and be trapped. Instead, you must break down their pagan altars, smash their sacred pillars, and cut down their Asherah poles. You must worship no other gods, for the Lord, whose very name is jealous, is a God who is jealous about his relationship with you. Okay? So, around your tables, discuss, what is God asking for? What is he telling? And then what does he mean when he says that his name is jealous? Okay, go. Okay. So, what, as you read Exodus 34, 10 to 14, he says, you're about to go into these lands, and there's people who live in these lands that have all kinds of cultural things, but also spiritual things going on where they're worshiping other gods, Baal, Asherah. They have all these temples built, and they have these monuments and these idols and these Asherah poles, all these things that they would use in their worship. What is God asking of his people? What does God want? You just talked about it for like 4 minutes. Somebody be brave. Nick. Okay, so he's asking them to destroy all the idols. Moses. Okay, follow him and not worship other gods. So destroying all the things would be a demonstration of him being God in their life. Cool, good. He wants our relationship with him to be exclusive. He's going, look, nobody else. I don't want anyone else to be more important than me in your life. Is that okay? Is that, what makes that okay? He's God, but can't God share? I mean, isn't that kind of narrow-minded to be like, wait, God, so no, nothing else? You just want me all to yourself? Isn't that kind of greedy? Isn't that a problem? Why isn't it a problem? Okay, so he's going to guide us. He's going to be a good guide. Well, let's move to this. He says his name is jealous. What does that mean to you? God's name is jealous. I thought we weren't supposed to be jealous. Okay. Care to elaborate on that? Okay. We'll talk more about it. It's fine. What else? His name is jealous. Awesome. Good. Good thought. Yeah. What does it mean when somebody says, like you're saying, oh, you better be pretty brave, and that person says, bravery is my middle name. What are they actually saying? That bravery is part of who they are. It's part of their character. So God, one of the things that we need to understand that God is saying here about himself. Okay, this is not somebody writing about God. God is saying this about himself. Jealousy is my middle name. And we stop because in our culture, typically is jealousy a good thing?
No.
We don't think of it as a good thing. We think of it as something that, man, if that person's jealous, they need to grow up. They need to mature. They need to get over it. They need to give that person their space. Whatever it is, we look at jealousy and we go,
We're not supposed to do that. But I want to ask you to think about something. What is the difference between being jealous of and being jealous for? What is the difference between being jealous of and being jealous for? There are some verses. There's a series of verses there on your paper. I want you to quickly, you don't have a lot of time, but quickly look those up and see what it has to say about being jealous of or being jealous for, and what is it that God's wanting us to understand through those verses. All right, so quickly look those up. Song of Songs is also Song of Solomon in maybe some of your Bibles. Oh, there we go, sorry. So maybe you got through all the verses, maybe you didn't, but we're going to quickly run through, because again, we're looking, if God says that his name is jealous, that must mean that there is some positive way to be jealous, right? Unless God just decides, well, yeah, this applies to you, but it doesn't apply to me. So what is the difference between being jealous of and being jealous for? Song of Songs, 8:6. Place me like a seal over your heart, like a seal on your arm. For love is as strong as death. It's jealousy as enduring as the grave. Love flashes like fire, the brightest kind of flame. In the Old Testament, a seal was one of the most important things that a person had, that a person could put on something. If something was really important to them, they would put their seal on it to designate, this is mine. And so here, it's telling us, look, put my seal, put God's seal on our heart, so that we are his, so that we are dedicated to him. It says, put the seal on your arm, so that it's not just a belief, it's not just something inward in our heart, but that our actions are impacted. So here, God is saying, I want to seal you as mine. I want you to know you are so valuable to me that I want my seal on your heart. I want you to be mine exclusively. Zechariah 8:1. Again, the word of the Lord Almighty came to me. This is what the Lord Almighty said. Zechariah was a prophet, so God's speaking to him. I am very jealous for Zion. I am burning with jealousy for her. Now, what does that mean? He's jealous for, now Zion was his people, okay? What does it mean that he's jealous for them? Okay, the attention is on them. What if he had said, I am jealous of my people? How would that change it?
It means that
he is jealous of, like, it's just happening. Yeah. Yeah, it's their actions are making him jealous, because, like, typically a person who feels jealous is probably what? There's this insecurity. There's this, like, oh, I'm jealous of what they have. I'm jealous of that guy because she's paying more attention to him than me. And so there's this insecurity. And so God is saying, I am jealous for my people. I am longing for my people. I want relationship with my people. He's not saying, I am jealous of my people. I am jealous of those gods that they're worshiping. All right? We got to move quick on this. Again, in 2 Corinthians, for I am jealous for you with the jealousy of God himself. I promise you as a pure bride to one husband, Christ, but I fear that somehow your pure and undivided devotion to Christ will be corrupted. And in James, and this was pretty common, in James, he says, you adulterous people. That's a pretty strong statement, right? But many times,
Many times, this was associated with spiritual adultery, where God is calling for faithfulness. God is calling for us to be exclusively His. And when our hearts are divided and we decide to serve other things, it's like spiritual adultery. And that's the word picture that is given. The biblical definition of jealousy, a definition is this: an exclusive single-mindedness of emotion. An exclusive single-mindedness of emotion. And we talked before, jealousy, jealous of versus jealous for. Self-interested jealousy, that's jealous of, is born out of and motivated by insecurity. It's born out of, self-interested jealousy says, oh, I wish I had that. I wish I was this. I wish I could be that. And it's self-interested. It's going, look, I'm insecure in who I am and what I have. And so therefore I envy, there's that word that was used earlier, I envy others, or I envy a different situation. So it's born out of and motivated by insecurity. So when you run across the issue of being jealous, or maybe someone you know is demonstrating jealousy, this is a way you can evaluate it. Is it being provoked and motivated by insecurity? Man, am I all bugged that my friend went over to this other friend's house this afternoon instead of coming over to my house? What's really bugging me? Is it just an insecurity? Oh, what if they have more fun at their house? And what does that drive you to do? Fine, they want to go to their house? Forget them. They're not coming over to my house anymore. That's one way to respond to jealousy. But then there's appropriate jealousy. This is jealous for, and it's born out of and motivated by a desire for genuine and close relationship. When God says that His name is jealous, see, too often we associate the idea of jealousy, meaning He's jealous of certain things. But God's jealousy for us, and that's what you see in those verses on your page, God's jealousy for us is motivated out of a longing for a close relationship with us. It's longing for time with us. It's longing for an intimate relationship with us that can't happen if our hearts are divided and we're all over the place. And in the Bible, in Exodus, He's specifically talking about don't worship other idols. Not because He's afraid that we're going to think those gods are more powerful, or He's hoping He can measure up. God's not insecure about who He is, but He longs for relationship with us. And so when we think about jealousy in that way, suddenly jealousy isn't this negative thing, this bad thing to be avoided. It's appropriate. Jealous of is basically envy. Jealous for wants to protect and maintain intimate relationship. I'll give you a really practical example that none of you have in your life right now, but someday maybe you will. I am jealous for my wife. I am jealous for my wife. I want to protect and maintain the intimate relationship that a husband and wife are supposed to have. And if something in that were to become broken, if something in that were to fade, I would be jealous for my wife. I may be tempted to be jealous of whatever is getting in the way, but there should be, shouldn't there, for a husband and wife, shouldn't there be a jealousy for, a longing for maintaining and protecting that marriage relationship? That's totally appropriate. We should be jealous for that. We should desire to maintain and protect that in our life. Jealousy is the passionate pursuit of exclusive love. Consider that as as you look at this, there can certainly be self-serving jealousy. And that is not what God is saying. God is not saying, I am jealous. You better not tick me off. You better not, start going around other people because I'm not sure who I am and you're going to make me jealous. He's going, look, I want an exclusive relationship with you. And this can play out in our own lives. What kind of jealousy are you dealing with in your life? Is it motivated and driven by insecurity? You don't like who you are. And so therefore, you look at others and there's all kinds of jealous of. Do you have relationships in your life that you are jealous for? Where your desire is a longing for authentic, genuine relationship. And some of you know exactly what that is. And you long for that. What about a jealous love for God? A jealousy for God where you passionately pursue that exclusive love of going, God, I want to be yours and yours alone. Not because I don't want you to be the jealous boyfriend, but because that's what God is offering to us and what God wants from us. So without exclusive love, there can be no intimacy. So as long as we keep responding, these boyfriends that hold on to their girlfriends like this and walk around and, oh, you gotta stay close to me, and oh, don't you talk to her, and don't you look at him, and all these things. Jealous for or jealous of? Jealous of. And when we live in this jealous love, there will not be any intimacy because it's the insecurity inside of us that's driving it. God is not jealous because he feels inferior to other gods. He's not jealous because he's afraid he might not measure up or that we might like baseball more than him or football. He wants so badly to have an exclusive relationship with you. He wants you to be jealous for that kind of relationship, to pursue love. So God, help us to make sense of this in our heart, because jealousy is something that we probably best know as negative and something that's painful and drives us to do bad things. But God, help us to see the jealous love that you have for us, the offering of exclusive relationship with you, where we carry your seal on our heart and we live for you. In Jesus' name. Amen.